Hello, my name is Guy de la Bedwyer, British historian and writer. I have a great interest in coins as very good examples of how you can reach out and touch history, and they have a great deal to tell us. Today I'm going to talk about how the figure of Britannia, seen here on a British penny of Queen Victoria of 1841, although Britannia was on British pennies right the way up until I was 10 years old in 1967, how that figure was derived ultimately from Roman coins, and there is the figure of Britannia on a sestertius struck by the Emperor Antoninus Pius in the year 143 in the city of Rome. It was a long journey. Okay, so if we start from roughly in the present, that's a British 50 pence piece. On the right hand side you can see a £1 coin and an American 25 cent quarter. They're just there for scale. This is a large size 50p. It was minted in 1969 as a brand new denomination, and there is Britannia on it, the seated figure of Britannia, no longer on the 50p, and incidentally, of course, since then the 50p has been significantly reduced in size. So where did this all kick off from? Well, if you go all the way back to the ancient world, the whole idea of seated figures on coin reverses was very well established. There is a god, in this case it's Zeus, on the back of a coin of, in fact, Alexander the Great, a posthumous issue of Alexander the Great. So a very normal idea in antiquity was the notion that you could represent gods as human forms and statuary or on coins. But perhaps slightly subtler was the idea of a personification. So this is a sestertius, a brass sestertius of the Emperor Nero, and about the time this was struck, a Roman soldier was paid around 900 of these a year. There, incidentally, is Nero on the other side. So it's a large coin. And Roma is represented by a female personification, very militarized to reflect Rome's imperial dominance of the world in those days. She's sitting on a pile of armaments, and she's holding a shield, and in her right hand is a trophy bearing a figure of victory. The large S and the C on the left and right hand side of the coin stand for Senatus Consulto, by order of the Senate, and of course there is the word Roma underneath to confirm her identity. Now the Romans developed that idea into all sorts of manifestations. They could represent joy, happiness, security. Various ideas could all be represented normally as female personifications. And that was also converted into the idea of representing places, Rome, but also provinces. Now, it's Hadrian, the emperor from 117 to 138 AD, so I suppose about 60 to 75 years after this coin was struck, he comes to Britain. And there he is, there's Hadrian. And this is an ass, or a quarter of a sestertius. And there, a little bit difficult to see, is the first figure of Britannia on a Roman coin. So the female personification idea has now been adapted to represent Britain. And it says Britannia just underneath the figure there. She's holding a shield, she's got her head in her hand, and she's holding a spear. It comes around the time that Hadrian visited in Britain himself, and that was when he ordered the construction of his wall across the northern part of the province. The coin may represent some sort of military victory in Britain, some sort of turmoil at the time that required the building of the wall. It's not until his successor, Antoninus Pius, that we see Britannia appearing again with any regularity. There is, in fact, a very rare sestertius version of Britannia under Hadrian, but it's very, very unusual, very difficult to find. So what we have now in the year 143, during the reign of Antoninus Pius, Britannia comes in big time on a large-ish issue of sestertii. There she is with her shield and trophy, and you can see the end of the legend, NIA, for Britannia there. This may well represent some sort of military victory in Britain, but it also commemorates the centenary of the invasion of the province of Britannia by the army of the Emperor Claudius in AD 43. It's too much of a coincidence for the year. It must be a commemorative issue. These coins, not that common, but they do turn up. And there's another one. There's another example there. There she is. And this is, it's very easy to confuse these with other provinces or female personifications. But Britannia always has some very distinctive features. And there's no question about the fact that that's her. And in fact, in a good light, you can see the end of the name Britannia on it anyway. Just as a curious matter of interest, these two, which also show Britannia, there we are, and this one here, very different colour, different size, but if you look carefully, you can see that the position of the lettering around the figure of Britannia is identical. All Roman coin dies were handmade. They were all individualized. They were never identical. Even in the same issues, you can just tell that you can distinguish them just by the slight positioning. But in this case, they're identical. This means these two coins were struck from the same physical dies at the Mint of Rome in the year 143. And the same match is evident on the obverse. Again, if you bother to line up all the letters and the exact proportions of the portrait, it's exactly the same on both sides. So these two coins were together once, perhaps in a bag in the Mint of Rome in 143. They've gone their separate ways, dispersed throughout the Roman world, and here they are back again after all that time. Now, if we jump on another 11 years, we come to this curious coin. This is an ass of Antoninus Pius, same emperor. And here we have Britannia again. And there is the word Britannia, you can see. Now, this coin is very distinctive. It mostly only turns up in Britain. Although it may be minted at Rome, some people think it was minted at a travelling mint. There's no evidence for either, in the sense of being able to confirm it one way or the other. All I can tell you is that they generally only turn up in Britain. So it looks like a distribution of coins in Britain, perhaps to commemorate some sort of military victory. Now, that is the last time that we see the figure of Britannia on a Roman coin seated like that. In fact, there's only one further recurrence of Britannia. If we go on to the reign of Commodus, who reigned between 180 and 192, and he was the successor of Marcus Aurelius, who had himself succeeded Antoninus Pius. This is a Victoriae Brit coin. If you look underneath the figure, it says Vict Brit, and this is a figure of victory. It's not Britannia. She's got wings, she's inscribing a victory on a shield, a very distinctive figure of a Roman military victory, and this commemorates a war in Britain in the year 184, fought by Commodus's armies in northern Britain. So it is a very specifically commemorative issue to celebrate a Roman war in Britain that year. If we go on a little bit further, we come to the reign of Septimius Severus. Now, it's not a particularly good coin here. Septimius Severus ruled from 193 to 211, and Septimius Severus resolved that he would fight a war in Britain. He was determined to toughen up his sons, Caracalla and Gaeta, who were loafing around in fleshpots in Rome. So in the year 208, with his wife Julia Domna and his sons in tow and a vast army, he set up camp, mainly in York, and then initiated a three-year campaign into northern Britain, which really achieved very little. The tribes in northern Britain, the part we call Scotland today, ran rings around Septimius Severus, trashing them left, right and centre. But that didn't stop Severus issuing his victorious Britannia coins. So Victoriae Brit there's a victory in the back of this coin. And also he issued them in the names of his sons. And in this particular case, this is a silver denarius of his son Gaeta. And if we flip it over, there is Victoriae Brit again, the British victories. Now, that is pretty much it for Britannia, or any reference to Britain on coins, until you get to the reign of a rebel emperor called Carausius. And Carausius was quite a chap. He was somebody who ruled Britain for about six or seven years in the late 3rd century. And I will just extract a coin of his. There he is. That's Carausius there. And Carausius, the rebel emperor, famous for his battle fleet. There we are. It's one of his ships on the back there. He did issue a coin in which he was being greeted by Britannia as some kind of messianic saviour of Britain. But that coin's very rare and I can't show that to you. So there we are. There's Carausius. Now, that's it. All the way through the Saxon and the medieval period, no more Britannia. It's not until you get to 1665. And there is a pattern farthing of Charles II. Not designed for circulation, a solid silver version of a farthing produced in 1665, the plague year. And he has copied, or his coin makers have copied, the figure of Britannia from the Hadrian coin. So what we've got there is Britannia now, and underneath, just like with the Hadrian coin, there is the word Britannia. In this case, the legend says, Quator Maria Vindico, I rule the four seas. So it's a typical British imperialist statement there of the coin, that there is Britannia ruling the waves. Now, this coin doesn't circulate, but apart from the fact that its bullion value does mean that it holds some value, something like probably a shilling, in fact, in silver content, but it's not really an official coin. Nor is this. This is the Breeder Medal of 1667. Now, this was produced by the Rothier brothers at the Mint in order to commemorate the Second Dutch War of Peace. And they have revived Britannia here on a magnificent big silver medal. There, incidentally, is Charles II on the other side. There he is. And the remarkable thing is that on the 25th of February 1667, the famous diarist Samuel Pepys saw it. This is what he says. At my goldsmith's did observe the king's new medal, wherein little there is Mrs. Stewart's face. He means a woman called Frances Stewart. As well done as ever I saw anything in my whole life, I think, and a pretty thing it is that he should choose her face to represent Britannia by. So there we are, a commemorative medal. Now, based on that essential design, within a few years, you get circulating copper halfpennies and farthings. And these become the mainstay of small change for the rest of the 17th century, although some were made of tin, and they're diabolically bad, and they're often worn because, of course, they were used to death, and they also last throughout the 18th century. So if we jump on just a bit to the 18th century, we can find ourselves with, for example, we have here halfpennies of George I and George II, respectively. So there is the figure of Britannia on an ordinary, everyday copper halfpenny. And that carries on right into the reign of George III. And there's an interesting aspect to this coming up. There is a halfpenny of George III, and that's from the 1770s, that particular coin. Now, the funny thing is that if you cross the Atlantic to North America, you find these coins, of course, were circulating, but that is the Revolutionary period. And after the Revolutionary War, the Americans are still trying to establish their coinage, but they can't really break out of the mold and what people are used to. So you get these post-colonial issues. And this one is a halfpenny of Connecticut. And it's dated 1787. But you can see it's got a figure that looks exactly like Britannia, because that's what people were used to. But it says, Ind et Lib, independence and liberty. And if we flip it over, there's George III. But there we have got Victoriae Connect, the victorious Connecticut. Now, because of the face, the way the king's facing here, actually what's happened is that that's been copied from an earlier coin of George II, because in British coinage the king changes direction with each alternate reign. So there you've got an American colonial coin which has really just copied Britannia and relabeled her, and we'll come back to that shortly. Now, not long after that, the Industrial Revolution comes in, and you start to get some very much more impressive coins. So there is a halfpenny of George III from 1799, produced at the Soho Mint on the steam presses at Birmingham. And that itself had followed on from the very inconvenient cartwheel pennies and tuppences from just a couple of years before. So if I pull 1799 out, there is the 1797 penny and tuppence, huge, great, heavy coins, which the 1799 really sort of started to replace. A much more usable halfpenny sized coin there. But it's not really until into the 19th century that you get properly struck penny coins rather than halfpennies with the figure of Britannia on the back. And if I jump all the way through the Georges to this, you can see here, there we have a large penny of Victoria. And on the reverse there is a very fine figure of Britannia. And that was reflected on the halfpennies and farthings as well. So really, once the steam presses get going under George III, you get all sorts of issues, but they're all broadly speaking the same. So this, for example, is William IV. That's Victoria's predecessor. And there he is. And there's Britannia on the back as well. So we are merrily trundling on through the 19th century, but it's in the later 19th century the size of the penny is drastically reduced because, of course, it's so inconvenient. And therefore we have here a penny of Victoria later in the reign, and there is 1891, there is Britannia. And likewise, this coin here, which is from the very end of Victoria's reign, 1901, you've got that. Now, I should have thrown in there along the way that throughout much of the 19th century, the United States were merrily issuing liberty-seated coins. So you can see there very much the template for liberty being Britannia. It's really just a modification. That one was struck in 1844 in New Orleans. And that dominates American coinage for much of the 19th century. Not all of it, by any means. Towards the end of the 19th century, dollars are the Morgan dollar design, which is completely different, and the Barber design, which has a completely different a Liberty head on it, rather than a seated Liberty. But throughout much of the 1800s, you would have seen coins like that circulating in the US. Right down on into the 20th century, it carries on with much the same. We have Britannia coins going all the way through the 20th century. So there is George V, that's 1918, from the end of the First World War, and there is Britannia. And I saw coins like that being issued right the way up until my childhood in 1967, until they were finally replaced. I really ought to throw in this. There's a Edward VII Britannia coin. So just before George V, that's 1909. And this one is a Votes for Women coin, which is interesting. It's been stamped by suffragettes for 1913 to publicise their cause. So there's lots of figures of Britannia there. I've shown you that there they all are. This all goes back to those Roman coins. If I just bring in that Antoninus Pius there, or from all that time ago. And then if all you're really going to find Britannia on today is on the government's silver bullion coins. And this one is from 2005. And there is Britannia. And you can see how very obviously it's been derived from the Roman figure of Britannia there on the left. So, sorry, that's all a little bit garbled and a bit of a whistle-stop tour. Britannia is not on current circulating coins. As I said earlier, the 50p coin has lost Britannia for the moment. And, of course, these days, the way people view that kind of culture, there's going to be a lot of resistance to it ever coming back. I'm not making any value judgments about it here at all. I'm just telling you this is how it is. The coins are all real. And they just have this remarkable history of Britannia on Roman coins and then disappearing until the 1660s, when Britannia is brought back and then becomes a fairly continuous visual feature of British coinage all the way down to modern times. Even if they don't really, Britannia doesn't really appear on circulating coins today. So there we are. Hope you found that interesting. Thank you very much.